Hello everyone. It's Friday. Come on in. Hope you have had a good drama-free day so far. Yeah. So it's good to see everybody. Just wait until everybody kind of gets in and gets settled. Let me know when you can see and hear. I'm not seeing the chat move. Here we go. Hey. I'm going to guess Marita. I know I've probably asked you that before, but I can't remember how to say your name. Hi, Carla. Hi, Annette. Hi, Vaughn and Ruth. Linda and Penn. Ina. JZ, otherwise known as Auntie Michael. Hi, Miriam. It's great to have you all joining me today. Hope you're doing well. Oh, must be gonna kiss a fool. Don't tell anybody. Hi, Marion. Hi, Travis. Good to see you, art journal guy. So what are you guys up to today? Marita, that was right. Oh, lucky guess. Lucky guess. Hi, Lizzie. From Chile. Wonderful. Hi, Yvonne. Hi, Barbara. Hi, Zandra. So nice to have you here. Nice to have you join me on... It's really a nice Friday here. Looking out my windows. You know, because we, of course, have to have the weather report, right? In the Midwest of the United States, it's kind of cloudy outside. We're getting past, I think we're past the hump of all the super hot weather. So... Yeah, so that's what we're hoping for anyway, because this has been one of the hottest summers around here that we've had in a while. Yeah, I hope so. I hope the heat wave is over. I really do. Anyway, so yeah, I think, Lizzie, I think you're the first person we've had from Chile here. So that's wonderful. Linda, how are you, Linda? I can't help myself. You make me laugh every time I see your name in the chat. So I'm surrounded by birds. We're going to the birds today. I'll show you birds. Birds and more birds. Ruth's having mater soup. Yeah, that's the way it rolls, isn't it, Annette? It was real hot yesterday, so that's when she went to buy and went to pick apples, of course. Of course. That's the way that works. So, did you guys follow me on Twitter? If you did you see Chance commandeered my Twitter account? And did you see his smiling face? If you don't follow me on Twitter, you should follow me on Twitter. It's at Barb Owen Designs, because every Friday, Chance or Charlie or Muppet or Coco or someone, some animal, commandeers my Twitter account and starts tweeting like crazy. And today it was Chance with his toothless smile. Oh, goodness. Son forgot to buy potatoes. That's not good. Hey, Kat. Hi, Frederica. And if I do mispronounce your name, please accept my apology and otherwise phonetically spell it out, except for Linda. Linda doesn't have to do that. I know how to say Linda. Feel free to do that. You might have to do it multiple times until it sticks. You know what I mean? Yeah, so those of you that were here last week or watched the recording know that Chance had had some teeth pulled. Yes, he had teeth pulled. Multiple teeth pulled. And now he's trying to figure out how to get the side of his mouth where they pulled the fang, one of those big, and Siamese have big fangs, and they're trying to figure out, he's trying to figure out where, what to do with the lip. So when he meows, his lip gets stuck and doesn't know where to go. So he spends a lot of time doing this with his tongue, trying to get it to go where it's supposed to go. Hi, Patricia. Hi, Marie. Who else did I miss? Hi, Lindy and Cindy. How's Cindy today? Cindy, you need, if at all possible, could you speak English? Because I don't know what, I don't speak French or whatever you're speaking. I pronounce it right, Frederica? Oh my goodness, that was a lucky guess. Hi, Mildred. And Aunt Beck. Yeah, I know, the poor cat. It is really funny. It is really funny. Anyway, welcome to the How to Get Creative show. HowToGetCreative.com show. It's Drama Free Friday, and I'm Barb Owen, and I'm really glad you're here. Thanks for joining me. We just spend a couple minutes chatting here in the beginning as people kind of get, you know, oriented. Hi, Jean. As everybody kind of gets in and gets oriented and, you know, gets their chat popped out or whatever. When I'm watching YouTube Live, what I do is I pop out the chat, and you'll see the chat window is... if you're on a computer anyway, the chat window is like below, hang on just a second, I need to get rid of something here. Okay, got it. The chat window is usually below your viewing window, and that you'll see down in the lower right hand corner some little dots, and you can pop out the chat, and then you can drag that window around where you want it, which for me makes it a more easier viewing experience. You think so, Jean? Jean thinks the chance of saying, don't you dare lock me in that dungeon today. You think so? Hi, Rebecca. Yeah. No, he's very capable. Listen. Siamese, if they didn't have a tooth in their head, could figure out how to meow. They could figure that out. Yes, they have no problem. They have a hard time. They have a hard time not being able to meow. So, hi, Debbie. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to talk about a few things. If Kasha, I don't know if Kasha's here. If she can hear me. Kasha, if you're here and can hear me, would you say hello? Because I wanted to ask you, something. So, if Kasha comes in, you guys tell her I'm looking for her, okay? All right. So I got a beautiful card this week from the one and only amazing cat hand. I just picked it up yesterday. It came to my post office box, and I don't get there very often, and so it's sometimes mail will sit there for a little while. Well, it depends on your computer. The chat's not beside mine on my laptop, so that's why I said that. Those of you that have it beside your viewing window, great. Okay. I know there are some of you that don't like the YouTube chat, and I apologize to you for not liking it, but can't do anything about it. Anyway, moving on. So, this week I got a lovely card in the mail. And this is from Cat Hand. And, I just thought it was so nice. Kat, thank you so much for this. This was what we did when we were streaming together. And I just was so tickled that she actually sent me the piece that she did when we were on, did our creative chat together. So if you are not familiar with what I'm talking about, if you will look on the YouTube channel and search Creative Chats, there is a playlist for Creative Chats, and you will see one in there. with cat hand. And this is what we did. So I just thought I would show you her card because it is absolutely, I mean, it's really lovely on screen. I wish you could see it in person because it is so much prettier in person. You know, everything is, right? And then she wrote a really sweet note inside. I love how she did this shaped addition on the inside. That's a really nice touch. So here is the one that I did. Our cards are slightly different in size because I backed mine with another piece of cardstock. So this is the one I did, and this is the one that she did. So I just thought it might be fun for you guys to see them side by side because they're similar, but they're really quite different. Isn't it nice? I know. These are her posies, and these are from one of her mixed media morsel techniques. But aren't they nice? Isn't that fun? I just thought it was great. So be sure, if you want to comment to me, if you want to get my attention, be sure that you put your comment in all caps. That would be wonderful. I know, wasn't that fun? There's Kasha. Okay, Kasha, I have a question for you. Kasha, is the article that's in here, is that by you? I'm waiting. I need for Kasha to answer me. Hi, Angel. I'm going to wait. Mr. Victor, hello. Nice to see you. So anyway, thank you so much, Kat. I really appreciate it. I love the card. I love it. I love it. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. No. Okay. Okay. Different Kasha. Okay. Got ya. So this is one of the magazines I bought this week, and I just thought I would show both of these to you. So this is Somerset Apprentice. Hi, Kathy. And if you're not familiar with the Somerset Apprentice magazine, I just thought I would show it to you because it's really a cool, fun magazine. If you are not, this is mixed media for the beginner, and this is one of the Somerset publications. They have many, many, many publications, as we've talked about before. But this one, what makes this different is that they'll do a project, like they'll give you a close-up of whatever the project is, and then here is the author or the designer, the author of the article, the designer of the project. But they go through much more detail, and I mean, it's not quite as step-by-step as a tutorial, but it's close, okay? And so I just wanted to show that to you because I don't know if some of you are familiar with this magazine, but it's really a nice magazine. So there's, and pretty much every article is like that. So it's stepped out with a lot of detail shots and photographs and so forth, and a lot of much more detailed than in most of the magazines. So it has just some really, really fun mixed media techniques and different color combinations and different just different fun ideas to get your interest going. So I just thought I would show that to you. I love this. Zandra loved this. Zandra, if you don't have this, you're going to want this. You're going to want this. You're going to want this article, Zandra. Zandra is our resident mermaid. This is right up her alley. Yes, this is right up her alley. So anyway, I just thought I would show you that. This is the current issue. Can you watch the magazines online? You mean like, Victor, you mean like download them from online? Is that what you mean? If you mean that, I'm not entirely sure. Hi, Susie. Is Clawsman going to make an appearance today? Probably only in the chat. I know, the shells are really cool. I'm telling you. If Xandra doesn't have that magazine, she'll be going and getting it. I just know. Maybe some of you guys know if these magazines are online, because I really don't know. There she is. Shells paint up so well. See, she already knows. She already knows. Xandra, do you know if these magazines are available online? Uh-oh, there's Clawsman. He's in the chat. I know. I do love Somerset magazines. I really do. So this is the September-October issue, 2016. And so this is Somerset Studio. This is the Art of Paper and Mixed Media. This magazine typically runs $10 here in the United States. And it's less expensive than most of their other publications. Most of the other ones run about $15 here in the U.S. So, okay, Xandra says she doesn't know, but she doesn't think so. Yeah, I'm just not entirely sure whether you can get them online or not. So, to answer your question, Victor, I don't know. I don't know. So, Tim Holtz has got all of his Halloween stuff out. If you're into Halloween, he has a lot of cool stuff. But one of the articles in here that was really great was this one. Christine, I don't know how to say her last name. I'm going to guess Peloquin, P-E-L-O-Q-U-I-N. Okay, Travis says he thinks that they have digital editions at Stampington.com. Okay, so take a look, Victor, take a look at Stampington.com and see about that, because I really don't know. I didn't even think to look it up. But this is, I love what she does. This is similar, I would have to say, it's not the same at all, but this artist and Christy Sobolewski share some things that are kind of similar to each other, in that they use a lot of mixed media and then paint figures or faces on top of them. But I just think her work is just really lovely. So I just thought that I would take a second and show these to you. But the realism that she captures within the face, I mean, I could see Kathy Arbor, who also does some phenomenal faces, really phenomenal faces. I can see where, you know, there are similarities. Nothing the same, but similar kinds of things with each other. But I mean, isn't that, I just think they're beautiful. So I just thought I would run through that article with you, because I thought it was really lovely. Then there's, and this is a mini book. That does not look so mini to me, gotta say. So anyway, and then there's an article, you know, talking about, this is another article by Michelle Ward called Sacred Earth. And in this one, she talks about collecting dirt and rocks and all different kinds of things from places that they've been, and putting them in little bottles and Point Pleasant, New Jersey, Kennebunkport, Maine. Seaside Heights in New Jersey, you know, putting sand and things. One of the things, and this was a really cool thing, back years ago, our son was in North Carolina, and he was out there for an acting thing that he was doing. And when we weren't able to go out, he was in North Carolina. Yeah, we weren't able to go out there during the time he was there. So when he came home, he brought us the ocean water in bottles, and he brought us sand from the beach in a container. It was just a really, really special, really special thing that he did. Xandra says it's that Mount Pleasant is very close to where she lives. How cool is that? This is sea glass that she's put in jars. I know, I truly never thought of collecting things like that, you know, that would be such a fun collection to have, you know. I mean, that's truly a souvenir from the places you've been. But that's an article by Michelle Ward. One of the things they always have in the issue of Somerset Studio is they have artist papers. And so they'll have the different artists on the back. This was Caitlin Mendoza with artist elements from Joey, J-O-H-W-E-Y, Reddington. And this one right here is Caitlin Mendoza with artist elements from Christine Pelliquin, who is the one I just showed you a minute ago. And this is Caitlin Mendoza with artist elements from Jean K. Brown. And this one, I have to say, these kinds of figures like this, this probably is just fine with most of you, but I personally find this kind of figure disturbing. Hey, Jamie. I do find, okay, Vaughn says, via Vaughn, hi Vaughn, says Somerset does have digital subscriptions. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for that. So, Victor, if you go to somerset.com, they do have digital subscriptions, so that might be something you might check into. Yeah, I find this kind of figure a little disturbing. I don't know why. It's not the bird. It's the combination. Yeah, it's not my favorite. But some people will love that. So, anyway, lots of... This was a funny one. Let's see if I can find it again. Witch houses. Wicked easy witch houses. I told my husband I could make, I knew a few people I could make some houses for. Not mentioning any names. You can't make me mention a name. Anyway, good magazine. Good magazine. I recommend them. Hi, Patty. Hi, Janice. So I did a couple more mandalas this week. I thought I would just show them to you. So this is, you know, it's like, well, this is this one. Let me move my illegal fluids out of the way. I'll show it to you a little closer up. So here is this one. This has a lot of metallic pen work on it. I'm tipping it just so maybe you can catch the glint. All the gold is metallic. Thank you, Linda. It might be Ruth. I don't know. Joey? J-O-H-W-E-Y might be Joey. I really don't know. Yeah. So there's that one. So these are cards, in case you haven't seen these before. These are cards. And the mandala is this, and then it's, I put it on cardstock and then attach it to the card. I don't remember whether I showed you this one or not, so I'll show you that one again. I think this one is a new one too. I don't think I showed you that one. Hi, Patty Ann. We have a Patty and a Patty Ann. Nice. It's so great to have you guys here today. Thank you for joining me for a drama-free zone. And this one, I don't think I showed you this one. This one is entirely detailed using this clear star, Jelly Roll clear star pen. And so when I tip this, I'm going to see if I can catch the detail. When I tip it slowly, you should see all the detail there now. So it's kind of holographic. Yeah, kind of holographic. When you tip it. But when you look at it straight on, it just looks quite flat. You know, you see the color from the pencils. But then when you tip it, you get it to a point where everything pops up and you get to see all of the design work. So I did that just because I wanted to see what would happen. And I know I've shown these other ones before, but I'll show them to you again real quickly. This is experimenting with complementary colors. Many of these are done with analogous colors close to each other on the color wheel. This one I did purposely to do complementary colors, blue and orange. So this is more of a analogous, all things are next to each other. Okay, Aunt Beck Creation says, for an FYI, Somerset Studio is offering a free ephemera pack with a subscription and the show at international subscription and they show an international subscription option. Okay, cool. Thanks, Vaughn. Hi, Sherry. Hi, Susie. And so this is the other one. Again, many of them I've done, you know, pretty analogous. Some of them monochromatic, but this most of them analogous. So anyway, I just thought I'd show you those. So I do those when I'm just, I do them at odd times. I'm writing a course, a mandala course, for all different kinds of mandalas. And so these are, I'm working on some of the techniques and things, doing them on the cards. So just thought I'd show those to you. And the funny thing about them is, when I'm working on them, oftentimes I go, oh my gosh, this is the ugliest one I have ever done. This one isn't even going to make a card. I'm not even going to put it on a card. It's too ugly. And then I keep going. And all of a sudden it's like, well, that's going to be okay. You know, and then especially if I set it aside and don't look at it for a little while and I come back in the studio or pick it up again, I like, you know, I like that. So, thank you. Ruth says, thank you for not making me pick a favorite. I wouldn't do that to you. All right, let me get rid of the illegal fluids and let's go to the bird, shall we? Oh, I forgot to show you the books from last week. We'll take a gander through that. Hello, is it Ro? Roesta? You'll have to tell me what to call you. How about if I call you Ro till you tell me differently? All right, so last week we did these little books, envelope books. And so what I thought I would do is show you the finished book. Now this doesn't have anything in it yet, and I haven't put anything on the cover, words or anything. But anyway, this is a piece of paste paper that I put on the cover. This is paste paper inside the cover. And the there are videos that I have on my channel that are sample video classes from HowToGetCreative.com. There's two of them on paste paper. So you can Google that or search it on my channel, paste paper. Just search it on my channel is your best thing. And you'll find the videos on doing that. Row. Okay, thank you. I'm so happy. I'm so happy. And so this is the one that we worked on last week, right? So this is the one where we created the envelopes. So this is the last stream. Created the envelopes, stitched them into the binding, and then closed up the envelope. So this is a stitched book. If you didn't happen to see it, that's what we did last week. This is the stitched binding. And then the ribbons hold the spine closed. All right, so as you recall, there were these fins. Between every two envelopes, there was a fin. And I wasn't quite sure what I was going to do with that. Annette says, how many books do I have? Okay, I'm just going to have to laugh at that for a little bit because it's a very loaded question, and I'm just going to say I plead the fifth, okay? I plead the fifth. yes, I plead the fifth on that one. So what I did is I took tags, and this is black. This is a black tag that was pre-made. This tag I found it Tuesday morning, and it was text, okay? And you can kind of maybe sort of see it. Yeah, Ruth says, we don't have that kind of time. That's right. We do not. I'll show this to you up close here. Let me So I want you to see the text. Let's see. You can maybe kind of see it. Let me zoom way in. Can you see the text in the tag? Let me go this way. There, you can see the words. So there are words in these small tags, right? Hi, Eileen. Nope, you can't. I'm not falling for it. I'm not falling for it. You cannot make me count my books. No way. So what I did is I mixed up some paste paint, like the paste paper from the paste paper videos, and then I did the paste paint technique on top of the tags. Now, there is a tag here and a tag here. Same thing, two tags. And I've sandwiched them over the fin, and so that gives me a space to add a quote or to do something. I'm not sure what. And I need to add, I used silk ribbons. I put some silk ribbons in here, and then I wanted the pull to be very small, and so I cut them very short. But I need to go back and add a little drop of glue right in here just so they don't come out, because they're cut short enough. If they ever come out, I'm not getting them back in. So, okay, so then what I did, my intention was to get the ones on this side to look good, hopefully with what comes after it as well, but mostly with what's, you can see the most of the other envelope. Okay, so same thing here. I wanted them to look good with this one, but mostly, you know, go with this, hence the kind of reddish tones. But the black, what you see here, the black that's coming through, that is the actual tag itself. Don't ask Clawsman. Do not ask him about my books. That's no fair. That is no fair. And don't ask, if Race Owen shows up, the technical department shows up in the chat, do not say one word to him about my book collection, people. You're all dead meat if you do. Okay, so each one of the tags is different. Some of them have metallic paint, especially in this. This is metallic green. But you can see, so this is what I did on this one. Okay, so I made everything to go with this kind of grungy color palette of this Tim Holtz paper, with a little, you know, pizzazz thrown in for good measure. All right, so here you can really see the grunge look on this one. This one, it's not quite as black as it appears here. And then I put, this is paste paper I had on hand, but it was like the perfect thing for this, right? It was like the perfect thing. And then that's the back cover. This is also paste paper. It has a lot of metallic paint in it, so it's quite shiny. All right, so that's that one. That's the one, the version that we did on the stream last week. This is the version I had done ahead of time. I think the cover had the paste paper on it. I'm not entirely sure how much I got done for you guys. This is paste paper. So this is the one I had done ahead of time, so it is much brighter in color. So the papers on this one are where I cleaned off my brayer when I was jelly plate printing. Hi, Shu. And so, yeah, and this one, this one has a little faux pas in it. You're not supposed to point out your mistakes, but there, you can see it has a little extra crease. I'm going to have to go back and add a little something to this because my stylus went wonky on me. Anyway, I'll fix it. So the tags in this one are much brighter. These started with either a manila tag or a tag that had some red and gold and stuff on it. So you might be able to see, probably not. There's a reflection in here of some gold glitter. So these tags are much brighter because the whole color palette of this is much brighter. Hey, Vicky. Hi, Deborah. Well, you know, let me just tell you, if you're struggling not to buy more books, you need to just tune out and go somewhere else because you're going to get enabled here. The handprints from these are masks that I had. They're not anybody's handprints. They were some things that I bought. but they are adorable. So these are all paste paper, and these are all basically junk papers, but a much, much brighter color palette. So the tags are much brighter as well. Again, one tag on each side, another tag, you know, so there's two tags back to back. The holes up here at the top didn't line up exactly, but you know, sometimes you just kind of, it's like, don't look at it. If you don't like it, don't look at it. So there you go. So that is that one. So I just thought I would show that to you so you could see that I really do finish, get some things finished. And this is another piece of paste paper for the back cover. And there is the back cover. There you go. Hi, Lena. Nice to have you join us. Now, that's not a stencil. It's not a stencil from anybody. These are old masks that that I bought. They were sold, getting rid of them at a store. They were getting rid of them. They had them marked way down, so they were getting rid of them. You can't even get them anymore. So you have to make your own, or you have to find somebody. These are actually a mask. They're not a stencil. They're actually a mask. It's a shape, the hand shape. So there's a whole bunch of them in that pack, which I use all the time, and it's a shame that you can't get them because I love them so much, and I talk about them all the time. And I show them on when I stream and I do classes all the time because I love them so much and you can't get them. So you have to make your own or find somebody to do them for you. Deborah says, can't tune out. This way I can just say, Barb made me do it. Thanks for that. Hi, Dana. You like the bright one. Linda says she likes the bright one the best. So what's your vote? Which one do you like the best? The more vintage one or the brighter one? That'll be interesting to know which one you like the best. I'm going to watch the chat for a second. So do you like the bright one or the vintage colors better? Yvonne says she likes them. So thanks for that. Okay, while you guys are putting it in, what you like, here we go, bright, okay, Pasqualina, what, was your name Patty? I see you asking me a question. I'll answer it in just a second. The vintage one, brighter, show us both. Show us both. Whippy has to make life complicated, doesn't she? All right, I'll show them both to you. I don't know. Let me see if I can get them in the same shot. You won't be able to see them all, but you'll be able to see parts of. Okay? Show them both together so you'll get to see. Okay? So the top one is the bright one. The bottom one is the vintage one. Okay, so top is bright, bottom is vintage. It seems like it's either both or bright. You're welcome, Carol. Whippy Carol. Okay, so you kind of get the idea. I mean, you can tell this is definitely a more muted palette. This is the palette I'm more drawn to, the bright ones. Plus, I love the fact that this is entirely made of my papers, you know, that I've created. This is a scrapbook cardstock that I used in conjunction with my own stuff. So there are the two. Side by side. Okay. So the question was, what is paste paper? If you will look, search my channel for paste paper. So just put in you'll find a little search box there and just put in paste paper. You'll have two video classes that'll come up. They're long video classes. They are sample video classes from HowToGetCreative.com from the membership area. There's 10 full-length classes on the channel here, on the YouTube channel, that you can watch for free. And then that gives you a good idea of what the website membership is like, because those are a really good sampling of the classes. And you'll find that exactly how to do the paste paper, because I show you step by step by step how to do it. Okay? It's basically an art paste that's mixed into acrylic paint. So that's the very short answer. Okay? All right. All right. Got to get rid of the illegal fluids here. Off the table. Before I get in trouble with the technical department, who I don't think he's here today, so I think we'll be okay, because we will be using water and paint. Oh, thanks, Ruth. Ruth says she likes the class notes. Yeah, every one of my classes has a full-length picture tutorial, written instructions. Many of them are, I'd say the shortest one's 15 pages and the longest one's probably 45 pages. But every class has a step-by-step written tutorial with it, with photographs that are taken directly from the video. So there's no new There are seldom... I seldom add new photographs of things that are not in the class unless I am augmenting, for some reason, the class. You know, I need, like, it's like, okay, I need a few more pictures to make that clearer, you know, then I'll go back and do that. So, if you did one season of the, we're in season three. I'm finishing up the last class for season three from HowToGetCreative.com membership. And so we have three seasons of classes online, plus the original 10. And so if you were to only do one season of classes, you know, sign up for several months or whatever it is, however long that lasted, you would end up with a binder that was like this thick of tutorials, the written tutorials. So... you saw another Owen here. Oh no, Mildred, say it ain't so. Hi, Meg. Hi, Scribble Artie. and Terry. Hello, Terry, in case I miss saying hello. Okay. So what we're going to do is I'm going to show you some of the birds that Clawsman has carved and that I painted, and then we're going to paint some. And we'll see where we get. That's the plan. So this time of year, which is the fall here where I live, we move into Santa time of the year, because Clawsman gets his name because he carved Santa Clauses from basswood, northern basswood. So he carves Santa Clauses this time of year, and then I paint them, and we have collectors. I mean, they are first come, first serve. If someone online wants one, and we have collectors waiting in the wings here, but the people online snap them up first, then that's what happens. We do a very limited number. This year we are doing far less than we have ever done, and the reason for that is because I don't have time to do all the stuff. Because what happens, the process is, this is in relationship to Santa Clauses versus birds. Santa Clauses, Clawsman carves the Santa and he gets it completely finished, and then he gives it to me, and then I paint it, and then I finish it. So it's painted and varnished and finished. We add accessories to them. Oftentimes, like last year, they all included, or most of them anyway, included an animal, whether it was a cat, a dog, or a bird. Those are also hand-carved and painted and finished. So those are added to the pieces. Sometimes we put a piece of glass or a gemstone that Clawsman wire sculpts, and that's added to it. So the pieces are... they're not just a carving, they are a sculptural piece. Anyway, then when that's all done, then I sit down and I write the stories that go with them. So each one gets his name and his own little story that goes with them. So Yeah, so that's the fall of the year for about, it just depends on when I can squeeze them in and when I have the time to do it. So this year we got started a little bit early, thankfully. And he's got, looking over on the bench, he's got one, two, three, he's got four pieces that are done. There's actually a snowman this year. I think we have two snow people and three, I'm looking around the a sign that's in my way, and three Santa Clauses that are finished so far. So none of them are painted, they're just carved. It is a lot of work. It is. And we don't charge nearly enough for them, I'm just telling you. Okay, so that's Santa, pardon me, Santa Claus. Santa Claus Land. When I was a kid, my parents took me to Santa Claus Land, Santa Claus, Indiana. I have photographs to prove it. I have a picture, like a milk pitcher, with Santa Claus, Indiana on it. I loved it. It was a great place, and I should have known it was going to foreshadow something that was going to happen in my life. I had no idea that I was going to be doing Santa Clauses to the degree that we have done hundreds of them. So, all right. So what we're going to do today, though, we're not talking Santas, we're talking birds. So I just thought I'm going to quickly show you some of the birds that he's carved, and I think I've painted. Yeah, I think I've done all the painting on these. They're various. This spans a lot of years of painting. So some of these are painted in oil, which I do not do anymore. I do everything in acrylic now, but some of these are painted in oil, but they're all hand carved. Okay, so let me get my camera situated here just a little bit. And the light is not super great because if I turn on another light, it ends up totally blowing out the color. And so we're just going to look at them as best we can. So this is, I've forgotten what kind of ducks these are. Anyway, this is done in oil. Okay. So this is a very old duck. These particular ones have glass eyes in them. Oh, thanks, you. All right, so this is one of the ducks. Let me try this other light just for a minute. Yeah, it's going to blow the color out a little bit, but you might be able to see it a little bit better. Yeah, it's going to reflect and kind of blow out the color, but anyway, you might be able to see the detail better. Okay, so this is one of the ducks. All right, that's that one. This one's also done in oil. It's a mallard. And I can see that some of the, these have been through a lot, these poor things. Redneck duck. Okay, I don't know what it is. I know this is a mallard, but this one's also done in oil. Three-dimensional objects painted in oil are very challenging, let me just say. I have another duck here. I think this one was done in oil too, but it's been a long time ago. I don't know the name of this one either. I think one's a wood duck, maybe. They're quacky ducks. Yeah, I painted all these as well. 1986. So they've been around a while. Now, truthfully, you can't get the same effect with acrylic that you can get with oil, but I get pretty close. I get pretty close. So anyway, there's that one. I don't remember what this one is. So I'm going to show you all the ducks. This one's not painted. I have two of them here that are not painted, so I'm just going to show those at the same time. This one's walnut, and there's no point in painting something that where the wood is that beautiful. I'm just showing you the grain of the wood. And Clawsman, and he doesn't have eyes in this one. Claus Man's in the chat, so if you want to ask him questions, you can. I don't remember what this one was, if it was walnut also, but this one has the glass eyes. They're all wood ducks. Okay, that's true. That's very true, Miriam. They're all wood ducks. That's very true. Good point. All right, so those are the decoy type ducks. Then we go into, these are shorebirds. And they're tall. They're tall. So I'm going to have to kind of show them to you at a funny angle. But this is a shorebird. So you can see. So this is done in acrylic. And this is supposed, this is reminiscent of how they stand on one leg. And the base, I don't know where the base came from. Looks like cedar. I don't know. Anyway, that's a shorebird. This is another shorebird. So, again, they're long-billed. These are a challenge to show you because they're on tall bases. I guess on another piece of cedar. Anyway, so those are shorebirds. Okay. Now, I'm going to take a second. I'm going to move these out of the way. And then I'm going to show you the songbirds, or wild birds, as it were. So these are all things from our personal collection. Oh, I have some small ducks, too. I can show those to you. Okay, so let me show you these little ducks. So here's a little mallard, and this one, I think this one was carved by our son, I believe. His name's on the bottom of it, so I think he's the one that carved this one. A long time. That takes a long time. It really does. And here's another one, another small one. I love the little ones. And I couldn't tell you if these were done in oil or acrylic. Too long ago. Too long ago. But anyway, there's the little miniature ducks. All right, so that I think is all the ducks and the waterfowl. Then we have some wild birds and some songbirds. This is a mourning dove, and she perches on a hunk of wood, so she's a mourning dove. She's one of those that goes, hoo, 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 and drives you bananas. No wonder people shoot them. They drive you flipping crazy listening to them. So anyway, there is a mourning dove. If I get the names wrong on any of these, somebody will correct me, I'm sure. All right, these are some little guys that are just, the painting technique on these is just a stained technique. So these are wrens. This is a wren, and this has just been stained. There's not been any special technique, except what I want to show you about these. This one, here's another one. Okay, and if you'll notice, see the big white splotches on it over here and the white speckles? They're not really supposed to be like that. Yeah, they're not really supposed to be like that. I'll explain that to you in a second. And this is a finch. Again, these are just, this is a goldfinch and just stained. So they're not heavily painted at all. But she also, or he, I think this is a male, has some speckles of paint on it, right? Here's a bluebird. This one, he used wire. You can buy the wire feet, and then they have these bits at the bottom so you can mount them into a piece of wood. got any Oregon ducks. Hey, Deb. I don't. Darn it. So this is a bluebird, but as you can see, do you see how it's also speckled? Yes. Yes. Okay, so here's the sad truth about these. There's this one, and this one, and this one, and this one. All right, so here's what happens, folks. If you're not careful when you're splattering things, that's what happens. So I was splattering something, and back in the day when I was doing this, it wasn't called splattering. It was called fly specking. Okay, I was fly specking something, and I fly specked or splattered all this whole bunch of birds. I don't have a clue what I was fly specking. Yes. So yeah, they need a little tender loving care, but all they do is get put back in the cabinet. And every time I get them out, I laugh about it because it's like, yeah, I remember doing that. I don't know what in the world I was doing, but I sure did fly speck them. Yes, yes, I did. All right, so this is one of my favorite pieces. Sponsors did it. Now, unfortunately, hey, CB, unfortunately, it was before the days of the sponsors. We can't even blame them. Okay, let me back out just a little bit. Not too much. I'm trying to get up close enough that you can see the parts without giving you more, too much background noise. Anyway, these are a pair of goldfinches, and this, when he did these, when Clawsman carved these are the shavings from the wood, and so he made the nest from the shavings from the wood. Okay, so that's where her nest came from. There are no eggs in there, but that is what the nest came from. So it's all built from the shavings from the wood that created the birds. Bye, Kat. Good to see you. So anyway, those are goldfinches. We have lots of goldfinches around here. Okay, this piece is much bigger, so I'm going to have to, again, show it to you kind of in pieces. Let me back out a little bit, zoom out, and see if I can give you more. This is a bigger piece. This is a pair of cardinals. This actually was a piece that we did and gave to my parents. And so, of course, my parents are gone, and so it now lives with us. Hi, Carol TMD. And I don't remember if these are done in oil or acrylic. These were some of the early birds. Ah, that's a terrible pun. These were some of the earlier pieces that I painted, and so not much detail on these. Anyway, so yeah, so there's cardinals. The carving is actually better on these than the painting, for sure. For sure. Okay, so that is the cardinals. And then we have some quail, so I thought I would show you the quail. So this is, I really don't know if this is a female quail or, the story of the quail is this. I have to tell you the story of the quail, right? So there's the quail. She, we'll call it a she because I really don't know. Clawsman did a tutorial on the website for carving sweet potatoes. So we do have a sweet potato carving class on the website in the membership area, and then I do a follow-up class on painting the dried sweet potato, but that's as far as we've gotten with him doing carving tutorials. Yeah, the carving classes. So So this is one of the quail. I have another one. Okay, so I got to tell you the story. We'll do it this way, so you can look at me and you can look at them. So he brought me this other quail, and it's a little harder to show you, but we'll see if we can get it on here. This was the second quail that he brought for me to paint. So let me see if I can show you this one. It's much bigger. You're probably going to get a shot of other parts of my desk. You're going to get more stuff that you got to look at because it's so big. Okay, so this quail is a big piece. Get this other stuff out of the way so you can really see it. Pardon all the gunk that you have to see in the shot with it, but it's big. Okay, so he did this quail in flight. Has a piece of old antique barbed wire in it and some pieces of wood. And then this is a pod that used to... Okay, this is why I hate hot glue. Okay, this is hot glued on there one time. And the hot glue dries out and gives away. I'm just saying. A friend of mine and I had this discussion the other day. I said, I absolutely hate hot glue. She says, I love it. I'm like, I hate it. I'm telling you. Anyway, I digress. So anyway, here is the quail in flight. Okay, so he brings me the bird. You know, just the bird. It's not mounted or anything. Brings me the bird and wants me to paint it. And so I said, well, I don't know what a quail looks like. I said, I need some reference photos. And so we started, this was back, okay, this is how long ago this was. It was back before the internet existed, folks. It didn't even exist. I should not admit that. It's just the truth, folks. It's just the truth. Anyway, so I was having to use magazines or whatever, right? I was having to use magazines and books and stuff like that. Well, every single, and you can see the breast under here, right? Okay, so every single thing that we referenced, that we collected for the reference for this bird, I'll put it over here so you can see it, was different. The colors were different because the artist's interpretations were different. So every single thing I had to look at was different. And so I'd start painting and I'd, you know, do a little bit on it. And I'd say, well, does that look right? And he'd say, no, it doesn't look right. You know, well, what should it look like? Well, you know, he had a hard time describing it to me because he doesn't see the pieces the same way I do, obviously. Because if he did, he'd do it himself. Travis says he was around before the internet too, so it didn't matter. Good. I'm glad I'm not the only one. So anyway, one day he came home from work. He is a contractor by trade. He came home from doing his real job, and he said, I have something for you, and he gave me a paper bag. And I said, hi, Krissa. I said, what is it? And he says, it's quail parts. Yeah, quail parts, people. He had found somebody who had been quail hunting, and he brought me a wing, and the wing had part of the breast attached to it, and there was part of the tail, and, you know, there was no head, obviously, but there was, you know, little parts and pieces. He says, I can't get much more real for you than that. And I'm like, okay, well, that's, you know, gross, but good. Gross, but good. Hi, Angie. Yeah, so I took a really good look at those wings. I was studying the feathers and stuff and kind of getting the idea of how it was painted, right? And I was really excited to see the real thing because I could get the real colors of the browns and the gold and the grays and all that kind of stuff. So I'm thinking, this is great. I'm going to work on this tonight. And this, we lived in a completely different house. My area where I painted was in the basement, so I had the table set up and had the bird parts in a bag, you know, on the table with my quail, and I'm going to do it that night. I went downstairs that night, and there is nothing left, but a few feathers. Because the cat that we had at that time thought, yay, dinner, she ate my sample. Yes, she did. Yeah, ate my sample, she did. Rotten, rotten cat. So fortunately, I'd gotten a good look at it before she did that. Anyway, yeah. It's terrible. Yeah, ew, that's right. They weren't even sponsors. She was just a bad cat. She was a cat that was looking for a home, and we took her in. She ate my samples. Yeah. Anyway, I got the quail painted. I got it approved by Claus Man. He said, yeah, that looks like a quail. I'm like, well, I am so grateful because I had worried over that quail for I don't know how long. Anyway, this is the last one I'm going to show you, and then we're going to actually paint a little bit. And this piece is so big, I'm going to have to show it to you this way. This is a quarter scale eagle. Okay, so this is an eagle in flight, and it is a quarter scale. So if you blow this up by 4 times and it quickly gets really big, that's the size. 4 times the size is the size of a real bald eagle. So this was one of the first pieces that I did in acrylic. So I don't know whether you can see it or not, but this is all done in acrylic paint. So this was one of the first ones that I did, and it's been a while. I don't know if this is dated or not. I don't see a date on this one. Claus Man's not very good about dating his stuff. Yeah, I don't see the date on it. Anyway, this was done a while back. It had to have been done. It was before, or I did this after we moved into this house, so it had to be in the early 90s, maybe 1990, 91. Anyway. So that is the eagle. I was really tickled with how it turned out. I especially like the face. I don't know if you can see. Let me see if I can show you the face of this one. And try and zoom in on this camera. So there. So I was really pleased with how the face turned out. Anyway, so that is a bald eagle in flight. So that is one of my favorite pieces. They're all my favorites, but that's one of my real favorites. Okay, hi Kia, sorry if I missed it saying hello to anybody. I'm so glad you're here. Thank you for joining me. So what I have today is, now that I've shown you all that real stuff, now we're going to play now we're going to do fantasy. We're going to do fantasy birds. How's that? Trying to get my camera set up here. Okay, good enough. All right, so what we have here is we have 3 birds. They are carved, and they have been coated in gesso. These birds have been around for a while, and so it's time to give them some feathers. And so we're going to play with them and just see what happens. But I'm not going to do them in real colors. I'm going to do them in fantasy colors. Just because. Deb says she wants to come and sit in that there chair right next to me while I'm streaming. Deb, come on over, girl. Come on over. Why are we painting angry birds? Oh, you just never know. You just never know. They might be very happy. time for a little tea break here. All right. So I have an assortment of various brushes here, and I just use whatever strikes my fancy at the time it seems to be the right thing to use. And I have a container for water. This is water that I have mixed some, you can see some bubbles in it. This has some Murphy oil soap in the water, because I find that it helps release the paint out of my brushes. So, I didn't used to do that. I do it now. Okay, so I'm going to have the water kind of off to the side here. It'll be where you can kind of see it. And these strange looking hook things that I have on here, that is so I can hook these on my microphone stand. Because when you're working, one of the challenges with working with three-dimensional objects like this is your hands get in it all the time. And so I use this as a way to hang on to it. So we've got screw eyes in them so that they can hang. But also that wire attached to it gives me something to kind of hang on to as I twist it to paint it. I have handles that have a screw in the end of the handle, and I can screw them into things to hold them, but then you have to go back and you have to patch the hole, and then you have to try to patch the painting. And so I've learned to just work with things, you know, as best I can this way and so forth. So we're going to start with one of these little ones, and maybe we'll start with this one. So these have all been gessoed, and I'm only going to do bright colors of paint. So the colors of paint that I have out are, and I got permission from Clawsman to do this, you know, so I don't have to do realism, because I'm not in the mood, folks. So what I have is Vivid Violet, Electric Pink, Cadmium Yellow, Bahama Blue. Those are all Deco Art colors. Or Americana Deco Art. This one is Americana Multi-Surface Satin in Apple Green, and then I have black and white. And I might pull out something else. Okay. Okay. I'm not sure what you guys are talking about. So I'm going to shake up my paints, and I'm just going to put some out on my palette. I'm using a disposable palette, and that is a paper palette. It's a lot like freezer paper. You could use freezer paper. I just tend to like that it's already put in a pad for me. And so I just tend to use that way when I'm tired of painting, or if the paint skims over on me too much. Try and get this in here where you can see it. And the paint skims over too much, I just rip off the paper and either use it. Sometimes I use it in other artwork, and sometimes I just toss it away. Whoop, that's a lot of turquoise right there. Ian says you can dip it by putting acrylic paint on top of the water and it will stick to the bird. I have heard of doing that. I have never done it, but it might be something would be fun to do too, for sure. Okay, so we've got bright colors of paint right here, okay? So here is our little bird that we're gonna work with. And the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to use a pencil, and I'm going to give myself some guidelines here. This is not the one I want to start with. This is the one I want to start with. Okay. So I'm going to give myself some guidelines here. As I said, these are not meant to be. If there's a bird like this out in the wilderness, in the wild, shall we say. I don't know. I've never seen it. All right, so I'm just going to divide it up. So I've got wings, I've got the back and the tail, I've got the head, I've got the belly. I'm going to bring this around a little bit more. And then I'm going to use my eraser and see if I can get rid of some of the first mark I put on here that I'm not crazy about. Chances are the acrylic paint will cover it up, but just in case. Okay, and then for the little beak here, I'm going to looking at some of these. Fantasy birds. Okay, so I've got some marks on it. Thanks, Lindy. Yeah, the lesser spotted generic bird. That's right, Ian. All right, I'm going to take off my holder bit because I'm going to do the back first. So I'm just going to grab a paintbrush. We're just going to grab one and I'm going to get a couple brushes. Okay, I wet the paintbrush first and then wipe it off of my paper towel. So paintbrushes start out damp. So let's start with turquoise. What do you say? And I'm just going to paint this bird. And I did coat these with gesso, which I don't normally do, but I did for these. It's always helpful, whether you're painting or carving or whatever, it's helpful to do something, to have something to kind of get you back into whatever it is that you're doing. I haven't painted these like in a long time. So it's a good idea to do something that's just completely fun. And the gesso will help seal the wood because these particular carved birds have been sitting around for a while. They're very dry. And so I knew that the gesso would help them not suck up quite as much paint. And when I get into tight spots, then I drop down to a different size paintbrush. And I will tell you right now that these will not get finished on this stream at all. But if I get them base coated, which is just blocking in the color, that will be great. I use my pinky finger to bridge the brush. And the base coating stage is one of the most important stages for painting, because this is where I get all the paint down on the item. So I cover all of, and I'm going to add some tangerine into the mix. This is where I get everything covered, and then from this point forward, then I can start, once it's base coated and everything is covered, absolutely, totally covered in paint, then I can go back and I can start adding details and just having fun with it. So we're going to give him an orange beak, bill, whatever you want to call it. If you have any questions, be sure you put them in caps. Oh, there we are, some. Barb, it would be a nice idea to crackle glaze a bird for texture. Good idea. Good idea. Yes, pinky finger out. That's right. That's right. Put out the pinky finger. Yeah, I see somebody commenting about the variety of what I do. That's called short attention span. That's what it's called. Yeah, that idea with the crackle is very good, Ian. Very good. Okay, so we have a little beak. We have a little blue back. I think I'm going to bring the tail around back, maybe do this belly area. Let's see, is that what I want to do? Maybe just the tail. We'll just do the tail here. And because everything is hand done, hand carved, hand painted, hand finished, you know, there are uniquenesses about each piece. That's just the way it is. So you can't have everything. You don't seek for perfection. I do seek quality, but I don't seek perfection. Okay, I can also do the belly of this bird. What I'm doing is working as much as I possibly can in one, you know, where I can get a hold of it. Then I'll hang it up to dry, and then I'll come back and do the other parts while I do a different bird. Okay, so the underbelly of this bird, we're gonna do yellow or green, maybe green. Yeah, that blue is great, isn't it? I got a world of it on my palette too. It's Bahama blue. It's a great color. It's one of my favorite colors by Americana, Bahama blue. I do really like the color palette of the Americana paints. So this is apple green. This is one of their satin paints. I have not tried any of their fluid paints yet. I am anxious to do that. They're not available here locally, and I'm gonna have to order some because I really want to try them. I want to see how they compare to the golden fluid acrylics, which I also love, but I tend not to use them because of the, although they're wonderful paints, I tend not to use them because of the cost of them. They're highly pigmented and they're wonderful, and I get, once I start using them, I don't want to go back and use anything else. So this is how my mind works. Don't use them or you're gonna get hooked on them and you're gonna become a paint snob and you're not gonna want to use anything else. So that's my logic. Flawed as it may be, that is my logic. So as I said, if this is a real bird, I would be very surprised. And as I said earlier, Clawsman is in the chat today. And so if you have questions, and he's going to try and field questions if I don't answer. He has permission to send me a text message to get my attention. Because sometimes you just have to watch what you're doing, you know? So that's a pretty green. So if I don't finish these today, which I know I won't, we'll plan on finishing them next week. At least one of them, so you can see the finish process as far as the painting goes. Ruth says, don't say that. They'll discontinue it. Yeah, they really better not discontinue Bahama Blue. It's just a beautiful color. It really is. Okay, I've rinsed out the brush, and I think we're going to give him, a yellow head. Because I can still get to the head, so we're going to do a yellow head. This is cadmium yellow. I love this shade of yellow. It's just one of those yummy, bright, gold yellow. Delicious color. Delicious! What'd Ian say? He used to make football nuts. He did plaster carvings in the shape of nuts. Had the football strip of your favorite team on them called football nuts. Oh, fun. Bye, Marie. Oops. Bye, Linda. Good to see you. Linda. Nice to have you join us today. Great to have everybody here. I'm so happy that you would come and spend your Friday with me today. Because after all, it is Drama Free Friday, better known as DFF. And why is it called Drama Free Friday, you ask? Whoops, something just fell off my shelf. Why is it called Drama Free Friday? Because there is plenty of drama in the world. And so for a couple of hours every week, we just pretend it doesn't exist. And we just have fun. And do something creative. And we just bury our heads in the sand. Because my philosophy is this. If you can do something about the drama that's going on in the world, then you need to get out there and do it. If you don't have the ability to do it and you can't do anything about it, worrying about it and fretting about it and talking about it is not going to change a thing. So, for a couple of hours, it's not going to hurt anything for anybody to just put their heads in the sand and just act like the world is a beautiful, wonderful place, because in fact it is, but sometimes you have to remind yourself of that, right? And just go to a space called Drama Free Friday. Okay, so there is our yellow-headed green belly backed something. Okay, so I'm going to rinse out my brush and I'm going to put the little hanger back in here. like so. And then I'm going to hang it right up on my microphone or my camera, the thing that holds my camera, which is right out of, you can't see it. Here, I'll give you a shot at where he's hanging. I'm working on it. I'm working on it. I got bad camera work going on here for a second. Okay, see where he is? So he's hanging right there, and this thing right here supports the camera that looks down on the area that I'm painting on. So that's where they're hanging, right here. Okay, just so you know. Just so you know, so I'll put that camera back. All right, let me get another shot of tea. Ah. Okay, let's do this big bird. Now they kind of got my sea legs under me a little bit. So we'll go to this big bird. Big bird. And I'm going to do something similar. This one is kind of already divided up for me, but I'm just need to figure out where the wing. Here, the wing is going to come up like this. So, okay, and his bill is already defined. Okay, he's pretty well defined for me. So it looks like the back and the head and the belly are all going to be one color. What color do you think I should paint the head, the back, and the belly on this one? See what you guys think. Looks pretty foul. That's right. By Zandra. What color do you think I should do the head and the belly and the back on this one? I must have quite a lag here at the moment because nobody's answering me. Here's our choices. There's our choices that we're working with today. Purple somewhere. Of course, Ruth would say purple. Spray my paints. Purple, green. I don't want to do black. But thank you for contributing, Lena. All right, we'll do purple. Okay, stop voting. We're doing purple. Anybody that said anything else, you've been outvoted. We're doing purple. Okay, so let's see. How am I going to do this exactly? All right, I'm going to start up here. This one's probably going to take a couple coats because this purple, I can tell by looking at it, is pretty translucent. Kind of a purplish pink, actually. Pinkish purple, rather. Every year I have to get a new set of brushes because I blow through a set of brushes doing Santa Clauses. Haven't bought any new ones this year, so we're dealing with the old ones from last year. In case you want to see more of Clawsman's carvings, back in December or January, earlier this year, when our son was home, also known as the technical department, when he was home, he did a stream with his dad, and he basically interviewed him and had got him, you know, asking him questions and things, and showed a lot of his carvings on that stream. So you can search for that also if you'd like to see more of his carvings. You'll see a bunch of these that I showed you today, however, but there are more. He did carve this. He carved everything I showed today, and he carved the birds that I'm doing here. Yep. He sure did. Sometimes you have to give things multiple coats of paint. And on the Santas, I don't have to do that, because on the Santas, I'm working on raw wood, where this is gessoed wood. And in case you hear the whining Siamese, he's trying to tell you that he's being killed in there, but he's not. He's quite fine. That he would like to convince everyone to feel very, very, very sorry for him, because When you are a Siamese cat, there should never be a door that should be closed. Ever. And that is akin to torture. So he's in there, and you can hear him making this funny sound with his mouth, where he's kind of making his mouth go, row, 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 you know, like he's moving his lips, moving his jaw around and making a funny noise. Anyway, don't buy it, people. Don't buy it. He's fine. He's fine. No matter what he says to you, he's fine. So one of the things that you get good at with practice is brush control. Now, that doesn't mean I don't screw something up occasionally, believe me. I still can mess it up. But when you paint a lot, you develop brush control, which means that the brush goes where you want it to go. And it means that you learn what size brush to use for a given situation. Case in point, I've got a little bitty spot here, so I'm going to drop down to a little bitty brush. My philosophy is always to use the very biggest brush I can possibly use, because I get smoother strokes, a smoother coat of paint. And so I use the biggest brush I can possibly use most of the time. Okay, so I'm going to have to tip this up and peek under here. Clawsman is known. He is famous for carving spaces that are really tough for me to get into to paint. I think I get him trained. about that, and then he'll come in and make these real deep cuts, and I'm like, I can't get the paintbrush in there, bud. So we have to have a little chat again. All right, so we've got coat number one of the purple. Look good? Debbie says since she dies, she's coming back as one of Claus Man's Santas because she bet it tickles when Barb paints the tummies. You will not believe the stories they tell me, Debbie. No, no, you wouldn't. You would not believe the stories that they tell. Some of them, even I have to exorcise them from some bad words occasionally. Because sometimes I have heard some bad words, and I have to get all the bad words out of them. Especially if Claus Man slips the gouge and slices his finger, which he does occasionally. Not very often, but once in a while. Okay, the beak. We have a beak, people. We're going to make the beak yellow this time. This is a prince bird. Okay, that's a good thought. This particular bird is a gift for one of our clients who is going to be celebrating. I think she's having, I've already forgotten what birthday she's having. But I think it is like, you know, one of those decade birthdays or something. And she's older. And in my experience, older people, she loves birds. And in my experience, the more brightly colored something is, the better older people like it. And I must be in that category because I love brightly colored things. Yes, it's true. I must be in that category. I do much prefer bright to vintage and things like that. Although I appreciate vintage. I'm just, you know, maybe it's because I'm vintage, you think? Okay, let's do the wings. It's her 90th birthday. Okay, I was kind of thinking I was going to say that, but then I thought, nah, I probably should not say the wrong thing. But we have carved and done several things for her. We also do, it's been a while since we've done it, but we also have a line of resin pieces that are all cast. They were originally wood carvings, and they've all been cast, made molds of, Claus Man did it, made molds and then cast them in resin. And we have everything, all of them are Santas except for one. I'll show you the one. Somebody remind me in a minute to show you the one. The one. He's one of my favorite pieces because I know so many people like him. Okay. Yeah, this one will definitely have to have another coat of purple. That purple was very translucent. Ian and I must be alike. He likes the big, bold colors, too. Okay. I'm glad I'm not the only one. The challenge with any three-dimensional thing is figuring out how to hold on to it. You knew what I was talking about, didn't you? Thank you. Clawsman came to the rescue. He brought me the piece I was going to tell you, show you, so I didn't have to get up and get it. I know this may get a little blurry for you because I'm up way too close to this camera, but I have to get up close to my eyeballs so I can see. Yeah, I do. All right, so we're going to have to paint the underneath part of the wing. Yeah, it's a real red-violet kind of color here we got going on. At this stage, what I try to make sure is that all of the raw wood is completely covered. In this case, the gessoed wood. And when this part of it is done, it should look, when the base coating is done, it should look pretty decent. It's far from finished, but it should still look pretty decent. Again, when you gotta get into these tight little spaces. I don't even know how he carves this stuff because I can't even get a brush in here to paint it. I have no idea how he does this. No idea. And you can't leave little bits and pieces unpainted because it will stick out like a sore thumb. No, Ruth, he's not bringing me that damn ugly woman. No, he is not bringing, we're not showing the ugly woman. Ugh. That ugly woman is too ugly for words. Okay, sometimes you get paint slopped where you don't want it, like I just did. You have to immediately get a damp brush and come in and remove the paint. And I mean immediately. You cannot sneeze, you cannot pass go, you cannot say I'll get to it in a minute. You have to immediately remove it because if you don't, it dries in a heartbeat. Yes, you did, Ruth. Ugh, that thing is so ugly. Ugh. I'm always being threatened with that ugly woman. Always being threatened with that ugly woman. She's gonna wind up in my Christmas stocking one day. I just know it. Oh, she's ugly. Woof. He keeps begging for me to paint it. I say, nope. Nope, it's the only thing I've ever just flat out refused to paint. You guys will know if I ever cave and paint the ugly woman, you will know that I have fallen on my head. I have suffered some sort of trauma to my brain. You will know beyond a shadow of a doubt that Barb is no longer well. And see how much better this Bahama blue is covering than the purple? Interesting, huh? Difference in opacity. No, no, she wouldn't. You can't take an ugly thing like that whose boobs are exposed and give that as a gift anywhere. No, no, you can't. Her boobs are hanging down past her waist. They're hanging out of her shirt. And somebody expects me to paint that. No. Not gonna happen. Not happening, people. It's worse than gravity. Ooh, I don't know what happened to this thing. I don't even know what kind of frame of mind Clawsman had to be in the day he carved to her. Sketchy. Sketchy, I tell you. Okay. So, I got to get the inside. You can see a little white in there. I got to get that little tip of that wing. Again, I don't know how in the world he carves this stuff, because I can't even get in there to paint it. This is when I can't talk, I can't breathe. Got blue paint on the tail, because I was trying to get in there with the paintbrush. All right. Whew, I made it. All right. Made it. All right, before I go on, let me see if this purple is dry enough. Yeah, it's dry enough. Let's give it another coat. And I'm going to try mixing a little of this other purple, which is purple pizzazz. Maybe I'll just put a coat of this on it instead of that other one. Gosh, these paints are just splurting out. Waste my paint. Gonna have some journal page backgrounds happening today. Yes, I will. All right, let's go with this color on top of the red violet just to see if we can get a better coat. Hi, Terry. It still may have to have another coat of paint after this one. The purple is just not covering quite as well. That's okay. He's gonna get feathers and or something on top of this anyway, so. And then he'll get shaded and, you know, he'll get his, all the detail stuff done, I mean. So would you guys enjoy seeing this whole process from beginning to end? If I continue painting the bird next week, or birds? You think that sounds like that would be fun? I usually don't try to, I try not to string things over from one week to the next, but you know, once in a while, it's not such a bad idea, right? Angie, my fairy treasure, says she loves purple pizzazz. Angie, I watched your last YouTube video on that collage work you were doing. That was absolutely stunning. If you guys are not aware of My Fairy Treasure's YouTube channel, you should check her out. She did a really beautiful collage technique on her last YouTube. Lindy, I was not. No, I'm talking about the ugly old carved woman up here. It's been haunting me for years. I need to throw her out. I need to let the trash man take her away. Then Claws Man would be upset with me. We can't have that. Can't have that. All that hard work going to waste. And again, I know this is going to get blurry because it's up too, way too close to the camera, but I got to be able to get it up there so I can see what I'm doing. Everybody has their things in life that are their challenges. And for me, it's my eyeballs. Getting things at the position where I can see them. I am just grateful that I can see. You know what I mean? So I just work, you know, work around and have 40 pairs of glasses and stuff like that. But I can see far better without glasses up close, and so that means, but I have to get it pretty close to my eyes, so every once in a while you'll see me hold something up way closer than you think I should hold it. It's because I'm trying to see it. Okay, back to the tiny little brush, and we'll put the rest of the purple down in there. It's probably still going to have another coat of paint. Even after this, I didn't realize this purple was quite this translucent. Okay, all right, so we got another coat of purple. We got the beak. Looks like this beak needs a touch up here. All right, we're ready to paint the tail. So, we're going to paint the tail. What color shall we paint the tail? I think maybe we're going to paint it green. I like that green. Bye, Dana. Nice to have you here. Good to see you. All right. So, I'm going to paint the tail. Yeah, it's those purples are, they're just not as highly pigmented as I expected them, although I've used them for a long time. I don't know what I did with them, but I've never had a problem with them. But, you know, I haven't used them in this way, so, you know, it's all a matter of getting used to things, right? Knowing what colors work well in certain circumstances and things like that. I know a lot of people are not fond of using yellow because of the same kind of thing. You know, it's hard to cover over things and it's hard to cover. Yellow is a challenging color, and in for certain things it can be more challenging than others, like painting walls and stuff like that. Yellow can be a real bugaboo. Translation, it can be a real challenge. So when I'm finished the base coating process, the pieces look like someone has colored them as though it were, I used to call it color book painting, but that was before the color book craze became so popular. And so it's no longer a particularly accurate description. But it should have the appearance, or it will have the appearance, of just being very blocky. Because it's color blocked. Okay. And one more little spot in here. Let's see, where is it? Right in here. All right, I think we got it. So he's ready to dry, and then I'll have to come back and give the purple yet another coat of paint. Okay, let me see if I can show it to you up here. Okay, so there he is, base coated. So you can see the colors. Okay? So we got him all base coated in. All right, let me coat the wings on the other one. So I'm going to trade places here. I think he's going to work out well. Yeah, I like it. Okay, we'll go back here. And I need to cut the wings on this one. So this little bird is going to get pink wings, because why not? I always love the pieces, whether it's a Santa, a bird, a whatever, when I get the paint on them, you know. And then the personality, as soon as I get them base coated, I begin to see the personality emerge. And what's funny is when he's carving, he sees one personality. And then when I paint, I often see a completely different personality. So we sometimes have to compromise. Because to me, it's so very obvious that this one, you know, on the Santas, especially this Santa needs this kind of kitty. You know, this one needs this kind of dog. This one needs this bird. I think it was last year I had him carve a sign for one of the Santas. And then I said, now what he needs is this tiny little bird that sits on top of the sign. And he goes, you've got to be kidding. No. No, I'm not. You should have heard all the words coming out of that across the room. Whew. He's over there muttering, saying, if I don't cut my hand off, it's going to be a miracle. Stuff like that. I said, don't worry about it. When you're done doing that, I have to paint it. So don't feel too put upon about this. And it was the perfect thing, and he was so cute. That's cute. He uses northern basswood. I don't know if he's... Yeah, there he is. He's cute. This is a cute little bird with pink wings on him. So as I was telling you earlier, we have a line of resin pieces. So we have pins, like pins that you would wear on a coat or a blazer. They're Santa Clauses. And we have ornaments. Our stock is kind of low. We still have quite a few pieces, but stock is not quite as great as it once was. We have a little set of three independent little gnome type Santas that sit on a base. They are adorable. I have to say, they are adorable. You know, they were a collector's series where you got one each year, and we still have some of those left. Those are all in resin. The resin pieces are all originally carved from the wood, and then he molds them and casts them in resin, and then when they come out of the mold, then I paint them and finish them. They're all hand-painted exactly like the wooden pieces are, and finished. And they're all unique, because even though they are cast in a mold, they are hand individually cast, and so every time one of them comes out of the mold, there are little subtle differences from one to another. And then when they're painted, they're all individually painted, of course, so you have individual idiosyncrasies from one to another. Okay, so there is this little bird in green and pink and yellow, and the blue is showing up as a pale blue on camera. It's much more of a turquoise in real life, as they say. All right, so this one's going to hang up, and I'll show you one of our most popular resin pieces. This is the only one that's not a... I'm going to get rid of my paint here. This is the only one that's not a Santa Claus. Okay? This is based on a real person. All right. Well, wait. Maybe I can do it on this other camera. Hold on. I know you're not seeing anything. I'm trying to get the right camera to show you. And I know that you all know this person, okay? Move this out of the way. Okay? So, I know that you all know this person. Just try and tell me you don't. Just try to tell me you don't, because I don't believe you. This is a necktie. Mm-hmm. Got the idea? Got the idea? Yeah. So he's done in resin. Originally, he was carved in wood. Can you see? Can you see? We must have a lag because nobody's getting into it. All right. The chat just came to a complete dead stop while I showed him. That's funny. All right, we have one more bird to do. So let's go back to... We'll go back over here. Put him there for a minute. I think I rendered everybody in the chat completely speechless. Rendered you guys completely speechless. Yeah. Yeah, you guys know him. You know him too, huh? Yep. Uh-huh. Oh, funny. Yes. We've given those to several people in our lives. Yes. Yes, we have. Yep, that's who it is, Ruth. That's who it is. Okay, so let's do this one last little bird. This little wire bit that's on this one, that he hangs on a base. The base is already done. And this little wire gets in my way. I may have to rip it off of here. Okay, so let's block him out. Okay, so I'm gonna finish drawing the wings here. See if they're about somewhat the same. Good enough. Okay. I'm gonna give him a little indicator of the rest of his beak here. We cast a whole bunch of those one year. Clawsman says I can take it off. I'm going to, because it's really in my way. He'll make another one. All right, done. I got it already. I took it off. Thanks. It was just flopping around in my way there. Okay, so what we're gonna do now, here's my palette. I brought it back. That might be what it means, Ruth. Bye, Kasha. Nice to have you join us. Okay, let's add another color into the mix here. What do I want to use? What? looking at my color palette here. Do I like those colors? Actually, you know, I really do like these colors together, so I'm just going to keep working with them. I like how these colors work together. All right. I'm going to go straight for the dark purple and see if I can get these wings. Yeah, it's still going to be translucent. I'm still going to have to give it multiple colors or coats, but that's all right. That's okay. When you have your heart set on something, you just have to work around it. So this is the darker purple, the purple pizzazz. Yeah, Ruth says, okay, she's going to quit talking about me painting that ugly woman. That would be a real good idea, Ruth. That would be a really good idea. Quit dogging me with the ugly woman. Now you're going to make me go over there and get that ugly thing and show it, because people here don't even know what I'm talking about. The things I do for you guys. The things I do. Going to have to get the ugly woman out. See, Ruth? See what you've done now? You did it. You made me get the ugly woman out. You just wouldn't let it alone. No, you wouldn't let it alone. You forced me to drag out the ugly woman. She might be the bride of the guy I just showed you. Although, I don't know. I think he might have a little too much class for her. Yeah. You're not going to get it, are you? You're not going to get it, are you?
No.
Poor old ugly thing. Okay, there it is. There she is in the flesh. Don't tell me I never showed her to you, okay? Don't tell me that I never showed her to you. She's gonna have her 15 minutes of fame right here, right now. Yes, there's her 15 minutes of fame. While I paint this other wing, you guys asked for it, so you're gonna have to put up with, you're gonna have to avert your eyes if you don't want to look at her. I'm just saying. While I paint this wing up by my face so I can see what I'm doing. See, I think that they might make a handsome pair, don't you think? Another thing that Clawsman is quite good at carving is hillbillies. And he carved quite a few hillbillies at one point. So he carved one for his brother-in-law. You know, these are the slouchy, you know, overalls hanging off the shoulder and all that kind of stuff. Scraggly beards and all. With the moonshine jug and all that. He had one time that he carved it with the overalls or whatever it was hanging down so low in the back that the crack of his butt was hanging out over the top. So Clawsman may come across as this sweet little Santa painter or carver. Yeah. Just saying. Not always. I'm just about done painting these purple wings here. So they can dry, because they'll have to have more paint. Something weird about that purple paint. Weird about it. Anyway, okay, so we have two purple wings. So he's going to get hung up here so he can dry a little bit. Cute! Angie, get your glasses on. You think this is... Okay, Angie, you're not going to ever convince me that that's cute. Okay, look at the face. Well, he did play some murderers. Yes, he did. This is her chest, which is very long and hanging out of the front of her blouse. Okay, so these are very long, droopy, saggy. Yes. She has a shape where you don't know if her bottom is in the front or the back. Okay, this is her front. This is her backside. So, I don't know which one is which. Beauty's in the eye of the beholder. Well, good luck beholding any beauty there. That, yes. All right. Sweetness, you've had your 15 minutes of fame. You will go back in your little cave where you came from. Okay. What time of day is it? 3:23. I've just yapped on and yapped on this whole time. Let's come back here to this one. Let's see if we can do a little bit more painting on this. I'd like to get all three of these base coated, because that way I can take a picture of them to put on the front of this video, because they will be in process that way. And anybody watching this recording, I hope you have successfully fast forwarded through it. Because for certain, there wasn't a lot, I mean, other than watching the carvings, there wasn't a lot of substance here today. Wasn't a lot of substance. All right, we got a little beak, bill, whatever they're called. What color head shall we have? No, Debbie. No. Debbie, no. CB knows that woman? Yeah. Yeah, we all know her. Yes, we all know her. Just like we all know him. Just like we all know him. Yes. Yes, we do. Okay, what color should we paint his head? Of the colors I have on my palette, which are green, purple. We're not doing purple. So green, turquoise, or pink, or that red violet, or orange. Is she wearing Halloween costume? No. No, that's her. She only wishes she could take that costume and mask off. I don't have any red. My reds aren't very good. Think I should do red? All right. Let's see what. How about alizarin crimson? That's Napa. I don't want to do that. We'll do alizarin crimson, see what it looks like. See, I ask you and then I do my own thing. Sorry. The lag is a killer sometimes. Yeah, see, this is another one of those really translucent colors. That's all right. I'll just give it some more coats of paint here in a little while. After it gets dry, I'll coat it again. Give it enough coats of paint till I finally get it to where it's a good solid color. Because you got to have that good solid base coat in order to start coming up from there to do whatever else is going to happen, which I really don't know because I have not pre-planned this. No, I haven't. I know it's a shock. It's a shock to think that I didn't plan this ahead. All right, so are you guys all satisfied now that you got to see the ugly woman? Poor old ugly thing. Sorry, I know you can't see, but I got to get it up here where I can. If it's you seeing or me seeing, we're all in trouble if I don't get to see it. So don't ask me about that ugly woman again. Gold makes everything better. That's true. It's not over yet. We are not done with these birds yet, let me tell you. Okay, so we have a red head, purple wings. All right, I'm out of places to hang on to it for now, so I'm going to have to hang it up and I'm going to have to come back to that one. All right, enough painting for today. What do you say? So here's our little flock of birds hanging on the camera rack stand. Can you see that one? Probably can't see that one. Okay, there's that one. Here's this one. And here's this one. Can you see them? Hopefully you can see them. All right, so we'll put them over here. Get them out of the way. Let them dry real well. Then I'll go back and give them more coats of paint. And then we'll see what happens next week. I don't know. I don't know what'll happen to them. Like I said, I don't pre-plan this stuff. I don't even pre-plan when I start painting the Santa Clauses. I grab a paint. The only thing I know about the Santa Clauses is I know what the face is going to be like because I have a specific method that I use for painting the faces, so I know what that's going to be like. Other than that, and I know they're going to have white beards because if they're not white, they don't look like Santa Claus. All right, so paints are cleaned up. Let me get the water off the table here, and we'll bring out the toothless sponsor and his friend. Poor boy. In case you don't know what I'm talking about, one of the sponsors had dental surgery and had to have a large number of teeth extracted. All right, let me get rid of the water and we will get the sponsors out. Are you coming out? Huh? Are you? Come on. Are you going to come say hello? Come on, Chance. Come on, kitty, kitty. Come here. Come here. You going to come say hi? Huh? Are you? You going to come and see if you can meow for the folks? You are? Okay. I have a frozen screen. I do. Don't think so. Not on this. Really? What happened here? Oh no, I should be all right. There we go. Sorry, I screwed myself up. Messed myself up. Yes. You love their meows? You should live with them. You should come live with them, Debbie. You will fall out of love with their meows fairly quickly. Okay, come here. I know. Come up here and say hello. And why do we call them the sponsors? Because they usually let me stream. Yes, they do. Charlie, I'm getting you, buddy. I'm just trying to rearrange things a minute. Hold on. So everybody doesn't have to look at all the monitors. Come here. He's like trying to, you know what a water balloon's like to hold on to? That's what Charlie is like. Trying to hold on to a water balloon. Hi. Are you saying hello? Hi. Can you say hi to the peoples? Can you say hi, people? Can you show them how you don't have so many teeth left in your head? Huh? Can you say hello? You don't look too bad right now. He's got his lips pretty well fixed at the moment. Scoot back just a little bit so they can see you just a little better. There we go. All right. Can you say hi? Can you say hello? I don't know. He may not want to be talking. He may be shy today. Are you shy? Can you guys hear him meow or purring? The ugly woman needs dental surgery and a facelift. Yes. She just needs to have her face kind of sliced off is what happens. She needs to have a clay face. She needs a mask. She needs a mask, doesn't she? You think so? They're just purring. They're not going to talk. I was hoping he'd meow so you could see how he has to fix his lips, but he's probably not going to talk about it. Are you going to talk? You going to say goodbye to everybody? See? Can you see? I don't know if you can see that. I'm trying to get the camera so you can see it. Can you say hello, goodbye? Can you? As soon as he meows, his lip gets hung up on his lower tooth and he doesn't know what to do with it. So he spends a lot of time trying to rearrange his mouth. All right, so there's Mr. Charlie. Here's Chance. Sponsors have made their debut. And for that, we are going to say thank you for spending the day with us, the afternoon. I appreciate you being here. Thanks for hanging out with us. We'll paint some more birds next week and see how they turn out. I don't know what they're going to do. You'll have to come back and find out. So thanks for being here. If you are interested in, if you like what I do, check out the website, HowToGetCreative.com. And it is a membership website. We have lots of classes there, lots of tutorials, lots of other things, tips and tricks videos, and all kinds of things going on there. And that is the story of that. And if I have my mouse, there we go. That's that's the story of that. We'll be back next week, same time, same place, 2 p.m. Eastern on Fridays, for another episode of Drama Free Friday. So I'll see you guys next week. Remember to get creative today, because you know it's easy. And I'll see you next time. Bye, everybody.